Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to our Tanya class. We are in the beginning. We finished chapter 7 last week, and we are now going to begin chapter 8. So we learned last week, in chapter 7, he discussed what happens, the difference between things that are permitted, but are done without a godly purpose, right? And things that are prohibited. And we learned that something that is permitted, if you do it for a selfish purpose, you bring that, the life force, the chayus, the life of that but that selfish act or thought or utterance, and you drag it down into the three unclean, into the realm of unholiness. We discussed that. But he said that that's done, that happens as a lefishah. In other words, it's only temporary, till you do tshuva, till you repent. And then the life force that you brought and dragged down into the unholy realm, you can bring it back up and re-include it into the realm of holiness. And that's the meaning of the word mutar, heter, that something is permitted. What does permitted mean? Let me give you an example, just to refresh in your memory. So you have a person that goes and eats a snack or breakfast, a meal. The meal is fully kosher. So it's heter, it's mutar, it's permitted. You're allowed to eat that meal because it's kosher. However, because it's there's two ways of eating breakfast. One way is you are now hungry and you want to eat and you want to preserve yourself and be healthy because you just like yourself and you want to be able to go and have a good time and you don't want to be hungry. So that's a permitted meal, but because it was done with self-centered motives, there was no holy goal, no holy end to it, no godly end to it. It was for yourself. You like this food. It's kosher, but you're eating it because it's delicious, you like it, that's why you're eating it. Because right now you have a desire, a selfish desire to eat delicious food.
Even if you say a bracha?
You say a bracha, of course. But the bracha is good. But why are you eating? Why are you eating that food? You're eating it for a self-centered purpose. Now, I want to discuss that. I'll discuss soon. What does it mean to self-centered? Isn't everything self-centered? So I'm going to discuss that in a minute, but let me get through this point. You're eating this meal for a self-centered purpose, for selfish reasons. The food itself, we said, is mutar, is permitted. But when you eat it for a selfish purpose, the life force of that food, which comes from the neutral realm, we learned, right? It's neutral. It's not holy and it's not unholy. It's neutral. But when you eat it for a self-centered purpose, what you did was you brought it down into the realm of unholiness, because selfishness is unholy. Selfishness is unholy. Why is selfishness unholy? What's wrong? You're not hurting anyone. You're not bothering anyone. So we discussed this number of times. Selfishness is unholy because it promulgates a falsehood. What's the falsehood? The falsehood is that you exist independent of God. Right now I'm taking care of my own needs because I want to be and I want to take care of myself and I'm important and I'm going to take care of what I want right now. That itself is a falsehood. What do you mean you exist as an independent? You're important. You're not important. Since when did you become important? Since when did your desires become paramount? There's only one real existence in this world. There's only one true existence in this world, and that is God. So if you're in service, you're in the service of God, great. Then you have a right to be here. You have a reason to be here. God wants you here. You're part of His reality. So you're not promulgating a falsehood when you're doing things for a godly purpose. But when you're doing things for a self-centered purpose, you're promulgating an absolute falsehood. What's the falsehood? That this thing exists outside of God.
Rabbi, if you're eating to help others,
So we'll talk about that. What does it mean, a godly purpose? So we'll get that in a minute. So when you're eating for selfish reasons, you drag down the life force that of your body, of your act of eating, and the life force of that food into the realm of unholiness, but only temporarily. Because it's not osur, meaning it's not locked up, it's not inherently part of the unholy realm. It could be brought out of there. When you repent and you start doing things for a holy purpose, for a godly purpose, then you bring that as well out. Okay? But something that's prohibited... A Jew eats a pork.
It's done.
So what happens is, so that the pork is part of the unholy realm to begin with. Inherently, it's part of the unholy realm. Right? So even if you use it, he's going to say over here. So he says that you can never bring out of there.
Another
you can never redeem that from the unholy realm. You can't redeem that from the unholy realm. That's what the word asur means. It is tied and shackled in the realm of unholiness. Now, what does it mean to eat something? I'll digress for a minute. What does it mean to eat something for a godly purpose? To do something for godly? You're eating breakfast. You have to think every time you're eating breakfast, God, this is for you. So first of all, when you make a bracha, when you make the blessing before you eat, first of all, you're recognizing that this is God's food, and you're getting, you know, you're eating it thanks to Him. He created and He's giving you the ability to eat it. But it's one step more. You have to, why are you eating? If you want to be healthy, why do you want to be healthy? See, you said before, if you want to help other people.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm going to be a healthy person, after I eat breakfast, I feel good. So I can go now to the hospital and visit the sick and
absolutely
cheer them up. That's a godly purpose.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good thing.
Brotherly love.
Good. So that's a mitzvah.
Could be the second.
So if you're doing it for such a purpose, that's great. So by every bite, do you have to think I'm doing this to go visit sick people? No. Obviously, you don't have to be. But if the general action of yours, your daily actions, you're aware that you are. That your purpose, your ultimate, your higher goal is to serve God and to do good things in this world. And that's why you want to be healthy. So every time you eat, it's part of that reality. It's towards that end. That's a good thing. So you brought it into the realm of holiness.
But when you're overeating?
If you're overeating, then why are you overeating? Answer that yourself. If you're a glutton, that's no good. Then it's selfish.
But sometimes, I'm going
to. No one has to be a glutton to serve God. You don't have to be a glutton to serve God. If you're eating for health reasons, to be able to be a healthy human being so you can do good in this world, that's a good purpose. But then you wouldn't be a glutton. You would stop at a normal pace and you'd just, for your health. If you're eating more than you need, it's because it's tasty food and you like to eat good food, so that's already a little selfish. So
I do.
It could be very nuanced, obviously. Mm-hmm. Your day can be compartmentalized very much. A minute you can be thinking about something more ideal. A minute later you can be in the world of unholiness. You shift back and forth. It's a very tricky thing. Mm-hmm. So chapter 80 begins like this. Let's begin. It's on page 31. What's wrong with eating something that's prohibited?
It's a sin. You're going against God.
It's the action. It's the act of eating the non-kosher food is a sin. That itself is sinful. What happens if you eat it with the intention to do something positive?
Can that be reversed?
Huh?
If it's not kosher, you cannot redeem it. You just said it. So there is no...
So let's say like this. Let's take a look inside over here. There's an additional aspect in the matter of forbidden foods. The reason they are called isur, chained, that they can't be redeemed, is that they are is that even in the case of one who has unwittingly eaten a forbidden food, intending it to give him strength to serve God. That means like this, you ate it b'shogeg, you ate it by mistake. You didn't even know there was a problem eating it. You didn't know there was a problem. And in fact, it goes even a step further. Not only did you not know there was a problem with this food, you ate it for a godly purpose. You ate this breakfast, this non-kosher breakfast, not knowing it's not kosher. And you ate it in order to serve God, to go learn a shir, to go learn it, to go to your Sunday morning class. So you should be held, you feel you should be not hungry, so you can concentrate better on your learning. And not only that, he says further, let's read this again, that even in the case of one who has unwittingly eaten a forbidden food, intending it to give him strength to serve God by the energy of it, and he has, moreover, actually carried out his intention. He went to the class, and he learned Torah on account of that being healthy based on that food. Having both studied and prayed with the energy of that food. So what is the story? What happens in that case? He says, and even then, nevertheless, the vitality contained therein does not ascend and become clothed in the words of the Torah of prayer. You see, what happens when you eat kosher food? For the purpose, like you ate breakfast before you came here. Why did you? Yeah, you ate because you didn't want to come here hungry, so you can learn better, you understand better. That's a godly breakfast. That's a godly breakfast. You took the food from the neutral realm and brought it up to holiness. Now, what does that mean, you brought it up to holiness? Not only did you bring it up to holiness, what you did was the energy of that food now became enclosed and part of the Torah learning that you're doing and the prayer that you're doing if you're going to daven. So the life force is now, not only is it giving you the ability to learn, but it's actually it being enclosed in the Torah that you're learning. The Torah that you're learning on account of that food is now, the food has been now enclosed in that in the Torah that you're learning. So it's a wonderful thing if you think about it. But what happens in the case if someone by mistake ate something that wasn't kosher? With the intention to learn Torah, and he actually did. He learned the Torah. So the intention was there. The action was there. You went and learned Torah. With the health of that food, with the strength of that food gave you. Nevertheless, he says, the vitality contained therein, the life force that is contained in that forbidden substance, does not ascend and become clothed in the words of the Torah of prayer, as is the case with permitted foods. When you eat something permitted, it becomes part of the Torah study and becomes elevated in the Torah study and becomes one with Hashem. But in the case of a non-kosher forbidden substance, that doesn't happen. By reason of its being held captive in the power of the Sitra Achra and the three unclean clippers, because that's the meaning of Osu. It is chained there. Nothing you can do can get it out of there. Even if you learned, you did it because you wanted to learn. You did it by mistake. You didn't even know it wasn't kosher. It can't be redeemed from this. It's locked up in the realm of unholiness. This is so even when the prohibition is a rabbinic enactment. It's not even prohibited by the Torah standard. It's prohibited by rabbinic enactment. For the words of the scribes are even more stringent than the words of the Torah and so forth. Sometimes the words of the rabbis, the prohibitions that they put on us, sometimes are treated with more strictness than even their biblical prohibitions. In order to give it strength, in order that people shouldn't think it's only rabbinic, so it's not so important. So they made it even stronger. But there's something, but what he's saying over here is, that means like this, something that was prohibited by Torah standards, but the rabbis, for whatever reason, came in later and prohibited it. So that which was neutral before became unneutral now, became part of the realm of unholiness by rabbinic enactment. Once it became, because starts receiving its life force from the unholy realm, you're unable to redeem it. So even if it's only something that's prohibited on the rabbinic levels, again, it's locked up in the realm of unholiness, and there's nothing you can do to get it out. Except if you do what he said in chapter 7, you do such a tshuva that's so powerful that the virtues, the sin become virtues, like we learned. But outside of that, it stays there. It cannot be redeemed. Now this is unique by forbidden foods. Because by forbidden foods you can see there's a possibility that you're using it for a godly purpose. Nevertheless, it can't get out. You understand? Mm-hmm. And therefore, he says, also the evil impulse, the Yetzirah, you know what the Yetzirah is? The evil inclination. Each one of us has one. We have an evil inclination, an evil impulse, the impulse that drags us to do things that are not proper. Therefore, also the evil old impulse and the force that stems after forbidden things is a demon of non-Jewish demons, which is the evil impulse of the nations of the world, whose souls are derived from the three unclean klipos. In other words, what he's saying is like this. Let's go a few more lines. On the other hand, the evil impulse and the craving force after permissible things to satisfy an appetite is the demon of Jewish demons, for it can be reverted to holiness as explained above. What is he saying over here? This is a very interesting point that he just made. There are three realms, we said, right? There's holiness, the holy realm, God's realm, and then God created the unholy realm. So that there should be a balance. We spoke about this. You should be able to choose between good and bad. In the unholy realm alone, there are two realms, the neutral and the utter unclean realm. He said that the two souls of a Yid, one comes from the realm of holiness, and one comes from the realm of the neutral unholy, the neutral klipa. The souls of the nations of the world, of the idol worship nations, comes from the totally unholy realm. So now, your entire existence, your body, your human soul, come from the neutral realm. Your godly soul comes from the holy realm. Is it possible that you should have a desire for something that's from the three unclean klipas? Could you have a desire for something that's totally unclean, that comes from the realm of the three unclean klipas? The truth is you shouldn't be able to. Because there's nothing in you that has anything, you have no connection to that realm. Your soul, your human soul, from which comes all your lusts and desires, are not related to the three unclean klipas. So how could it have a desire for something that comes from there? It's no relation to it. To give you an exciting example. Do you have a desire to eat earth? Could you have a desire to eat earth? No. A normal human being cannot have a desire to eat grass or earth. That's a desire for animals. An animal has a desire to eat earth, grass, straw. A human being has no such desire. Why? Because his soul is not an animal soul. He doesn't have the soul of an animal. An animal has the desire for such things. He's created, that's the way he's created. A human being is created different. You don't have a desire for animalistic desires. You don't have animalistic lusts. Because you're not related to that realm. You have no connection to that. If you do have a realm for grass, there's something wrong. A Jew, how could a Jew have a desire for lustful desires, for things that don't come from his realm? He has no connection. You have a connection to holiness or the neutral realm. How do you have a desire for unholiness? For total unholiness? For pork? How could a Jew have a desire for pork? He shouldn't have. It's not a healthy situation. It's not a normal thing. What?
Other human beings eat it?
Hold on a minute. That's not, no, what's it got to do with you?
Because other human beings don't eat grass, but they eat pork. Because they don't have desire for grass.
But you're not another human being. You don't share the same DNA as the other human being, a spiritual DNA, from which comes all these lusts. You don't share that DNA. So where do you get the lust for things that don't come from your realm? That you have no connection to them. You understand my question? I want to emphasize so you get the question here. Where does all your desires come from? Your desires for godly things comes from your godly soul. Your desires for worldly things comes from your worldly soul, your human soul. But what kind of human soul do you have? A Jewish human soul. What's a Jewish human soul? Klipas Nega, the neutral realm. So anything that comes from the neutral realm, I can see you want to have that. You're attracted to it. You have a connection. That's where you come from. But things that come from an unholy realm, where do you come to have a desire for that? So the Alter Rebbe says there's two types of Yetzirah. There's two demons. There's a Jewish demon is the one that desires for things that a Jew should desire for. And an idol worship demon, a non-Jewish demon and so on, that is the realm of the three unclean klipas. A Jew should have desires for selfish things, fine. You have a selfish soul. But things that the soul, it should share the same desire for the same things that for its soul comes from, which is Klipas Nega. So if you look in the words of the Alter Rebbe, he says over here there's a demon that is called a non-Jewish demon, and there's a Jewish demon. How is it that we have a desire to eat pork, or do things that are totally unholy, which come from a realm that we have really no connection to? Here's the answer. What did the Alter Rebbe say in chapter 7? When a person eats, a Jew, you, each one of us, any one of us, eats something, or does something, or speaks something, that is permitted. Right? Klipas Nega. It's the neutral klipa. But you did it for selfish reasons. What happens at that moment? Temporarily, where did you drag it down to? You became part of the unholy realm. Right? So you drag yourself down into the realm of unholiness. What happens when you drag yourself down to the realm of unholiness? You become connected to the world of unholiness. You become connected to the world of unholiness. And what happens when you can't get too connected to the world? If you do that again and again and again and again, you do things for selfish reasons. You find yourself in the realm of unholiness quite often. You know what happens when you find yourself in the realm of unholiness quite often? It starts sticking to you.
Contaminating yourself.
It starts sticking to you. And therefore, you can even desire it. You start having a connection to it, and that's how you start having a desire for those things as well. Which means that if a person that's born and he never did anything, a person that never did anything for selfish reasons, would never have a desire for an unholy act or thought or utterance. It's only once you found yourself in that realm that you can start having a desire for more of that realm. But you have to be the first one to bring yourself into that realm. You're not there by nature. How do you get into that unholy realm? By doing things for selfish reasons, permitted things for selfish reasons, which for time temporarily brings you down into the realm of unholiness. Boom, you're there. You start looking it, you start seeing it, you start smelling it, you start getting a desire for those things. To give you a ridiculous example, although it's obviously not a good example, if you took a human and you put him in among animals all day long, he may start liking what animals like. He probably wouldn't, because still, a human being could never become an animal. But imagine, a Jewish human soul is hanging around in the three unclean klipas too much. It's going to start wanting that. It's not going to start having a desire for those things.
He will get influenced by the environment.
And he's going to want it. And he's mm-hmm. going to have start having a desire. It's going to start
what if it's the other way
being
around?
Delicious to him.
But can you describe somebody the other way around? He's born into an unholy environment, and his neshama has to be so great that he despises what goes around him.
You could have very good non-Jews. Of course you could.
No, I'm thinking like Moses. He was born in that environment. And he was so different from them.
Moshe was involved.
So he has more merits than all of them.
Obviously, Moshe has a whole different kind of soul. We learned that in chapter mm-hmm. 2. But I thought you were talking about the other way. Someone that comes from the three unclean clippers and now starts hanging around in the realm of holiness.
But I've seen people who hang around in environments.
Yeah, they get influenced by
them.
Sure, they
get. But their character is so pure.
That they're not affected.
That they're not affected at all.
There's such a, yeah, just people that are, that
I've have seen
that.
It.
Yeah, the great tzaddikim. That's true. Yeah. Let's read these words again. Let's go back to page 31. Therefore, also the evil impulse, the Yetzirah, and the force that strains after forbidden things is a demon of non-Jewish demons, which is the evil impulse of the nations of the world and the nations whose souls are derived from the three unclean clippers. A soul that derives from the three unclean clippers is going to have a desire for things of the three unclean clippers. On the other hand, the evil impulse and the craving force after permissible things to satisfy an appetite is a demon of the Jewish demons. You have a desire for things that come from Klipas Noga, because you come from Klipas Noga, as is explained above. And the reason that we see that a lot of us have desires for unholy things, totally unholy, forbidden substances, is because we have given in so much to our selfish, permissible selfishness that we've brought ourselves into the realm of unholiness that we started liking that too. But on our own, we wouldn't have a connection there. We wouldn't have a desire for that. Naturally, we shouldn't be wanting such things. We only want it because we dragged ourselves in there by doing permissible things for selfish reasons. Now you're in there. You like what's going on there. You want anything that comes from three unclean clippers. It's a process. Nevertheless, before it has reverted to holiness, in other words, when you did something permissible for selfish reasons, oh, wait a minute, I didn't finish this. On the other hand, the second line over here, let's do that. On the other hand, the evil impulse and the craving force after permissible things to satisfy an appetite is a demon of the Jewish demons. Why? For it can be reverted to holiness. Because Klipas Noga can be reverted to holiness, and we have that path. We are from the realm of Klipas Noga, which has a little good in it, right? We learned it's a neutral, has the ability for both. So that's where our realm is. Nevertheless, before it has reverted to holiness, when you did something for selfish purpose and no godly intent at all, and therefore you brought it down into the realm of Klipa, it is sitra, in other words, while it's still there, and before you brought it into holiness, it is sitra achren klipa. And even afterwards, even after you brought it back to holiness, by doing tshuva, by repenting, right, and using it for a godly purpose and so on, a trace of it remains attached to the body. Since from each item of food and drink are immediately formed blood and flesh of his flesh. What happens is, so he's talking about a person that ate, like I gave the example before, a person eats a meal for selfish purposes. So you brought it down into the realm of unholiness, right? Permitted meal, kosher meal. He brought it down to the realm of unholiness. Correct? It's there only temporarily, he said, right? Till you bring it out of there through tshuva. But while it's there, before you did tshuva, before you repented, it's part of klipa. Right? It's part of the realm of unholiness. Meaning the three unclean clippers, you dragged it down. And even after you got it out of there through tshuva, there's a trace of that negativity that remains attached to your body. And we learned this already in chapter 7. which will only be cleansed once we're in the grave, the purgatory of the grave, if you remember. He's going to mention it again now. Why does a trace of it remain in your body? Because what happens the minute you eat something? You feel good. You feel satisfied, right? So that became life for your body. What kind of life was it? Life of the klipa, because you did it for a selfish reason. Later you take it out, that's fine. But that trace, because it right away became flesh and blood, it right away satisfied your flesh, your body. So that life force that you got from it was from the three unclean klipas for the moment. So that's a trace of that remains. And later on it'll be taken care of, as you'll see now. That is why the body must undergo the purgatory of the grave, in order to cleanse it and purify it of its uncleanness, which it had received from the enjoyment of mundane things and pleasures, which are derived from the uncleanness of the Klipas Nega and of the Jewish demons. Only one who has derived no enjoyment from this world all his life, as was the case with the saintly master Rabbi Yehuda the Prince, is spared this. And what does he mean by this, that you don't enjoy? It's not that you don't enjoy. If you're eating a Shabbos meal or even a Sunday morning meal and you're doing it for a godly purpose, the scrambled eggs could be tasty and your stomach is going to enjoy it. There's nothing wrong with that. That's just human air. That's our nature. It's going to be rotten food, we're not going to enjoy it. If it's going to be good food, we're going to enjoy it. But what he says over here, only one. Only someone who has derived no enjoyment, he means selfish enjoyment. Now that's a high, tall order. I mean, how many people, I mean, is Rabbi Yehuda Nasi, you know, one in general.
Very few.
Yeah. It's the ideal, obviously. That's why most of us are going to have purgatory of the grave, obviously. But if someone that can say about himself, and Rabbi Yehuda, the Talmud says that Rabbi Yehuda Nasi, when he died, before he died, he raised up his hands to heaven. He said, God, you know that I've never enjoyed anything of this world. Now, Rabbi Yehuda Nasi was a multi-billionaire. He had everything at his disposal. He was very wealthy. The Talmud talks about what he had in his house, but he himself never took any enjoyment of it. So that's a high level, you know. That's he really never enjoyed it. He didn't do it for his enjoyment at all. So he said, you know that I never did anything, not only for selfish purposes, I took no pleasure in this world. So the meaning of this is that someone that does things for selfish reasons, brings himself and the food and the life force of the food and everything into the realm of unholiness. And that sticks to you for a long time, even if once you did tshuva. And therefore you have to go through the purgatory. Such people that never do things for selfish reasons. And there are some people. They work at it. They work at themselves. So they don't have this. It's very few people. It's a tall order, no question about it. But as I mentioned to you before, the Alter Rebbe is laying out over here the realities. What's the real life? What's real? What's the reality? That's reality. What's Kedusha? There's a realm called Kedusha. There's a realm called Klipas Nega. There's a realm called Klipas Shlol. The three Klipas, the three unclean Klipas. And he tells you when you're here, when you're there, how, what your life is about. Later on, he's going to tell you how to deal with it, what to do, how to live life. First, he tells you what life is, what's the reality, to get to know what this world is. So now we gave an example, till now he gave an example of action, doing something that is permitted, they talked about forbidden food, right? That they are locked up in the realm of unholiness, even if you did it for a purpose that is godly. Right? So he said that if someone eats something that is unholy, so part of his trace of it stays in your body. That's when you're talking about something that you do, you act, you ate something. What about when you talk something you shouldn't? So that's what he's going to speak about now. Let's see what he says. As for innocent idle chatter, you're talking about sports, politics, the weather, whatever. You're just having, talking about anything. How was last night's dinner? You're just having idle chatter, not gossip. Not, of course, that's prohibited. But something that's innocent idle chatter. And you'll see soon what he means by innocent idle chatter. It's not so easy to fall into the kiss for something to be considered innocent idle chatter. Let's see what he says. As for innocent idle chatter, such as in the case of an ignoramus who cannot study. There's a law in the Torah, you have to learn Torah day and night. So every extra moment you have, you should be learning Torah. Of course, you're allowed to go work to make a living. You're allowed to eat to be healthy. You're allowed to sleep. So you're allowed to do things that you have to do for your preservation of your body, for your family, for your life. But once you're done working for the day, you're done eating, you should go learn. That's the mitzvah. So a person that's able to learn and doesn't learn, there's no such a thing as idle chatter. He's wasting time from good time that you could learn. So that's sinful. He's talking about over here, innocent idle chatter is only by a person that is a total ignoramus. He can't learn. He doesn't know how to learn. He never learned by a teacher. He doesn't have the skill. He just doesn't have the skill to learn. So what should he do? So he's allowed to talk idle chatter. Right? So it's innocent idle chatter. Let's read it. It's for the innocent idle chatter, such as in the case of an ignoramus who cannot study. He must. So still, innocent idle chatter for selfish purposes, like eating something is permitted for selfish purposes, right? It's not sinful. That's what he means. It's not sinful. So it's like kosher food that you ate for selfish purposes. So again, he says he must undergo. So something got stuck to his soul. It's a problem, right? He must undergo a cleansing of his soul to rid it of the uncleanness of this klipa through it being rolled in the hollow of the sling. As is stated in the Zohar Parshas B'Shalach, page 59. Let's go further a little. But with regard to forbidden speech, such as scoffing and slander and the like, which stem from the three completely unclean klipas, the hollow of the sling alone does not suffice to cleanse and remove the uncleanness of the soul, but it must descend into Gehenna and purgatory. Yeah. So he says like this. He talks about something called the hollow of the sling. In other words, like this. He said, someone that eats something that is kosher, but for selfish purposes, and he does tshuva later and brings it back into the realm of holiness, a trace of it stays in the body. And that, what takes care of that?
Purgatory.
Purgatory of the grave. What is purgatory of the grave? To be more specific, yeah. The Zohar talks about it, that the malach and the angels come and bang out the negative of the body in the grave. This is some spiritual thing, obviously. But they bang out like you take a garment that's a little dusty and you bang it out, right? So it gets rid of the dust. Simple dust you can get out by banging it, right? A simple thing like that you can get out by banging it. So this is pretty, it's not such a bad stain. I mean, it's permitted food, it wasn't prohibited, and you got most of it out of the realm of unholiness by doing tshuva, the little trace you can bang out, okay, fine. Now he says, but what happens with regard to forbidden for idle chatter, matters of the tongue?
Words.
So that he says, you undergo another type of purgatory. No, kafa kela, it's called. So over there, I think what he's saying is like this. So something very interesting is going to come up a number of times in Tanya. Which?
One second.
Don't look in there now. Let me explain this a second. It's very important. The soul has three garments, right? But what are the three garments? Thought, speech, and action. Which garment is more connected to the soul? Thought, speech, or action? Which one is deeper connected more deeply to the soul? Your thought. It's in your mind, your brain. You think. What's the next one? Which is a little further from the soul? Your tongue, your speech. Speech comes from a little inside. Your action is the furthest from your soul. It's the lowest. So when you messed up the action part of the soul, which is you ate something for a selfish purpose. Kosher food, again, permitted. So it leaves a trace. The trace is less severe than the trace that idle chatter leaves. Right? Because the idle chatter is a little closer to your soul. So the negativity, that idle chatter, dvarim b'teilim, things that you should, selfish utterances, makes a deeper mark on your soul than utter actions, than idle actions. So the idle actions, like eating something that is permitted but for selfish reasons, what do you do about that? You do tshuva, and then the purgatory of the grave. They bang it out like you're banging out a dusty shirt. Okay. But what happens if you spoke something for selfish reasons? It made a little bit of a deeper stain on your soul. It's a little more connected to your soul. So it has a deeper... So the negative effect is more. So it needs a greater cleansing afterwards, after you pass away. So what happens? What's the greater cleansing? It's called kafakela. Let me explain what kafakela is. I'm not going to get into it because I never saw it and I don't know what it is. I didn't experience it yet. But the Zohar tells us what it is. The Kabbalah Chassidus tells us what it is. Basically what it is when your neshama comes back to heaven, and your soul goes up to heaven after you pass away from this world. The soul got used to this world, right? The soul likes this world. It got used to it, and we see the pleasures of this world make an impression on us. We were drawn after it, right? And you come up to the other world, you begin to realize how silly, compared to that world, how silly the pleasures of this world were. You can't even believe that you ever gotten caught up with it. You can't believe that you ever got caught up with it. So the soul now goes back up to heaven and becomes once again familiar with the pleasures of heaven, with the pleasures of godliness, which is the ultimate pleasure, infinitely greater than any pleasure down here. So what the angels do is, to get rid of that stain of idle chatter, it throws your soul up and down from heaven to earth. Once you get familiar with the pleasures of heaven, it brings you back down to see and remind yourself of the pleasures of the earth, and it makes you sick. You can't believe that you ever got caught up with that. So that alone is a painful experience, but it cleanses that part of your soul. Okay. It's a form of purgatory. Kafakel, you know what Kafakel, it says by when King David killed Goliath. With a slingshot, right? It was a slingshot. So it was like it's some kind of stick. On the top of it is like a little vessel, a little receptacle. And you pull it and it slings the stone, and it went into the head of Goliath and killed him. That's what the neshamas go through in heaven. The angels fling it back and forth from heaven to earth, so it sees the contrast, and that's very painful for it. It sees the contrast. What it could have and what it got caught up with. You understand? So it feels bad that it ever got caught up with silliness down here. So that alone is painful. When it could be up there, and you should be throwing it back down here. So that's the pain, and that cleanses the soul from idle chatter. It's a little deeper stain, so it needs a little more of a... It's not just banging it out like in the grave on the body. It needs a little bit of a shake-up of the soul too. Okay. Let's read this again. As for innocent by this circle, yeah? As for innocent idle chatter, such as in the case of an ignoramus who cannot study, he must undergo a cleansing of his soul to rid it of the uncleanness of this klipa of talking idle chatter for selfish purposes through it being rolled in the hollow of the sling. As is stated in the Zohar, Parshas B'Shalah, page 59. But with regard to forbidden speech, that's a whole different story. That's already that's the three unclean klipas, such as scoffing and slander and the like, which stem from the three completely unclean klipas. The hollow of the sling alone does not suffice to cleanse and remove the uncleanness of the soul, but it must descend into Gehenna. Gehenna is hell. And then he continues,
so
too.
The word purgatory, is that Gehenom?
Gehenom, yeah. So too, he who is able to engage in Torah but occupies himself instead with frivolous things, that means he's not slandering, he's talking about sports, he's talking about the weather. But he is not an ignoramus, he could sit and learn at that time. So that's already sinful. You could learn and you're not. So that's not a neutral. That's not a neutral thing. That's already a problem. The hollow of the sling cannot itself effectively scour and cleanse the soul, but severe penalties are meted out for neglect of the Torah in particular. Apart from the general retribution for the neglect of a positive commandment through indolence, namely in the purgatory of snow, as is explained elsewhere.
We're getting familiar with purgatory here. Let me explain to you what he's saying over here. Wasting time and not learning is a very bad sin. Because Torah, learning Torah is a very important mitzvah, even more than others. So neglect of that is bad. That's sinful already. There's two types of sins, right? There's eating pork, getting up and doing something you're not allowed to do. But then there's another type of sin. You neglected to put on tefillin. So you didn't do anything wrong. On the contrary, you didn't do what you had to. It's a different kind of sin. One is to be bitul mitzvat aseh. You did not do what you're supposed to do. And the other is you did what you were not supposed to do. Why do you do things that you're not supposed to do? You eat pork. You eat something that's not kosher. You looked where you shouldn't. You spoke what you shouldn't. What happened? You got caught up in the heat of the moment, right? You're passionate. You have a passionate soul. You got excited and you want to do this. You know God doesn't want you, but I want it. And you do it anyway. It's a passion that brings you to do that. It's heat. You got caught up in the heat of the moment. That's what they call it, right? Because there's a fire to it. What causes you to not do what you have to? Laziness. Why didn't you put on tefillin? I'm lazy. Laziness comes from a cold place. You're calm, melancholy, you're down. It's cold, not hot. It's not a heat at the moment, that's why I did. No one says, why didn't you put on film? I got caught up in the heat at the moment. There's no connection there. It's because of laziness, coldness. You're cold to those things. You're not excited about it. The contrary. It comes from being cold to film. Right? That's why you're not doing it. So one is coming from a place of coldness, one is coming from a place of heat. So what's the remedy for things that, for a negative, doing something you're not allowed to do? It's called in the Zohar, Gehenim Shel Eish, the purgatory of fire. Because what happens, you have to clean the fire of the negative fire, so you have to clean it through fire. What's the purgatory for something that comes from being cold, because you're too lazy and cold. You're cold towards that. It doesn't talk to you. Tefillin. I'm not interested in tefillin. It doesn't speak to me. I'm cold towards it, right? I'm not on fire for tefillin. On the contrary, I'm cold towards tefillin. So the Gehenim Shel Shelig is the purgatory of snow, which is freezing. It's not cleans out those sins. Let's not get into it. I'm just giving you different types of things that go on in the afterlife to cleanse the soul. And again, none of this is meant to be a punishment. This is not meant to be punishment. It's meant to clean the soul. There are different types of stains on souls. There's stains that come from wine on your shirt. There's stains that come from grease. the different types of stains. You need different kind of bleaches. One needs this kind of bleach. One needs that kind of cleaning agent. In heaven, it's the same thing. The soul gets stained by all kinds of different stains. Heat stains, cold stains, this stain, that stain. It needs, and it has to undergo the different kinds of cleansing. But it's meant to clean you. So that once you're finished, you're all pure and clean, you can go into heaven and have an enjoyment and become one with Hashem again. So that's what he's going through a little bit, to just explain what happens when you drag yourself down into klipas nega, into the three unclean klipas. There's different kinds of situations, and each one is dealt with a different way.
So the shona hara, it's type of...
That's bad news, yeah. Mm-hmm. That needs kafakela. Oh, no, not kafakela. He said now that needs gehenim, that needs hell. So that comes, that's probably gehenim shel eish. That, why do you speak lashon hara? Why do you speak gossip? You got caught up in the moment, the heat of the moment, right? You're excited about speaking something negative, right? So the excitement is heat. You're going to have to undergo the Gehenim Shel Eish, the purgatory of fire. It's not physical fire, you understand? It's not what we're talking about here. It should never be, don't ever corrupt it and think that that's what it means.
That's something that I want to ask you, speak.
Oh, 1 second, before you ask. Then there's some sins that you need Gehenim Shel Shelag. Okay, let's see. Let's just finish up over here a second. So too, you'll ask in a minute, yeah? So too, he who is able to engage in Torah, but occupies himself instead with frivolous things, you're with me on this right column. The hollow of the sling cannot itself effectively scour and cleanse the soul, but severe penalties are meted out for neglect of the Torah in particular, apart from the general retribution for the neglect of a positive commandment through indolence, namely the purgatory of snow, as explained elsewhere. That's why I explained to you this: the purgatory of snow is for the not doing a positive, what you should have done. Because you're cold. You don't want to do it. You're not excited about it. So you need the purgatory. So when it comes to neglect of Torah study, it's even worse than that. Because Torah study is important, more important mitzvah. It's a greater mitzvah than all others. So all other mitzvah, you didn't build a sukkah. I'm not in the mood, right? You're cold. Gehenim shel shalit, that's really the purgatory of the snow. The
studying Torah for women as well, I mean, it's the same thing, women and men.
Maybe not as much, but it's, maybe not as much, no. Likewise, he who occupies himself with the sciences, this is a very important thing that he's going to talk now. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave this for next week. This is a very important subject. Till now, we spoke about... the phone died. It died exactly when it was supposed to. Till now, he talked about the garments of action and the garments of speech. Next week, he's going to talk about the garment of thought. And if you corrupt that, it's the worst corruption. It's a worse corruption than doing something wrong or speaking something wrong. Thinking something that's not proper is worse. We think the opposite, right? Action is the worst, right? I don't care what you think. I know what you do is
what
counts.
I want to ask you.
What was your question?
I want to ask you, because when you do an action, it's after you thought about something. First of all, you thought to do thing. Then you do an action.
Right, usually.
The action is basically... it's just an action.
Right.
But your thought about these bad things, for example, let's say that I want to go now to an unkosher restaurant for lunch. And I thought about it. But then when I physically do it, that's the easiest part, because I already decided in my mind to do it. So the thought is the most important, because without bad thought, you don't do bad things. You know what I mean?
I agree. But when he talks about the corruption of the mind, he's not talking about when you think about doing something wrong. It could be that also. But he's talking about when you start learning secular sciences, for example. We'll talk about it next week. I don't want to get into it. It's a very, very important topic, because it goes against the grain. It goes against what we think. It's very opposite of what most people think. You have to be careful with this. Hamaisa hua ikar. The main thing is action. Imagine someone said, on Pesach, I thought about eating matzah, but I didn't actually eat matzah. I thought about it. I even spoke about it. But I never ate the matzah. You wasted everything. It doesn't count. The mitzvah is to do it. Or if it sounds like, I thought about hitting you, but I didn't hit you. Which is worse? Hitting you is worse. Because as it relates to other people, action is worse. I thought about stealing, but I never stole. That's not as bad if I did steal. Stealing is, the sin is to steal, not to think about stealing. It's not a good thing to think about stealing either, but the actual sin in the Torah is to do it, not to act, not to think about it.
But
the problem is not so much thinking about it. What he's going to talk about...
Huh? Thinking is between you and God.
When you're talking about my relation with Hashem, what causes a deeper stain in my soul when I think negative thoughts? Because my thought is the most closest to my soul. So when you're measuring how much did you corrupt the world, action corrupts the world or makes the world a better place, depending if you did something wrong, you did something right. But when you're talking about corrupting your mind, your soul, it's what happens, that thought is even deeper connected. So this, I'm going to dedicate a class for that next Sunday. It's going to be fascinating. It's very good stuff. It's fundamental. So I'm going to leave you tonight, today, and go eat lunch.